After a crazy year in 2020, everybody's hoping for a calmer year, at least financially, in 2021, but I don't know how true that is. What's up, everybody? I am Jaspreet Singh from theminoritymindset.com, where money minds rethink rich. Living through 2020 was like living through a financial roller coaster. We experienced the fastest stock market crash in history, then we saw the highest unemployment rate in history, and then we saw the fastest stock market growth in history. At the time of recording this video, 2021 is just getting started, and it is working very hard to fill the shoes of 2020. Elon Musk passed Jeff Bezos as the richest man in the world. Bitcoin surged to over $40,000 a coin, and Joe Biden was certified as the 46th president of the United States of America. And as he was being certified by Congress, our United States Capitol went under siege and it was attacked. And as our United States Capitol was getting attacked, the stock market broke a new record high. I have said this time and time again on YouTube, but I don't have a crystal ball, so it is impossible for me or anybody to try to predict what's gonna happen in 2021, but I can almost guarantee that economically and financially, 2021 is going to be a crazy year. But I do spend a lot of time studying what's going on in the economy and in the financial world, which is why I wanna give you my thoughts on what's happening in the economy, the stock market, and the real estate market, and what you can kind of expect in 2021. So that's what I'm going to be going over in this video. So make sure you watch this video until the end. But before we get into that, I need you to do me a quick favor and smash that thumbs up button below, because the way the YouTube algorithm works, if you do not smash that thumbs up button, then YouTube is much less likely to show you and other people our financial news and education videos. I'm going to start by talking about the overall economy, and then I'm going to get into the stock market, and then I'm going to get into the real estate market. An easy way to test the health of our overall economy is by looking at the strength of our job market. Our economy relies on spending. You make money, and now when you have money, you can pay for your mortgage, or you can pay your rent, you can pay for your car payment, you can go to the mall and buy yourself some nice shoes, and then you can go to Chipotle and buy yourself some extra guac. When you spend money at Chipotle, or when you spend money buying a new car, now these companies make money, and now Chipotle has more money to open up a new store. When Chipotle opens up a new store, now this is gonna create more construction jobs, because we're gonna need people to build out this new store, and it's gonna create a new stream of income for a different real estate investor who actually owns this property, and then Chipotle is gonna have to hire people to run their store, and so that's gonna create more jobs inside of Chipotle. As Chipotle creates more jobs, now more people have an income stream, so more people can go out and buy a car, and more people can go buy a home, more people can shop in the mall, and more people can afford extra guac at Chipotle. This is how our economic cycle works. It's almost like a wheel that spins and spins, and as it spins, it gets bigger and bigger, because now more people have jobs, which means more people have money to spend, and when more people have money to spend, our economy grows even bigger. But the whole system relies on people spending money, because if people don't have money to spend, then they can't spend, and now the whole system fails. If you don't have a job, now you can't afford to go out and eat at Chipotle, let alone buy extra guac, and you can't afford your car payment, you can't afford your rent or your mortgage payment, and you don't have money to go to the mall and start shopping. Now, if you don't have a job, and you are not spending your money, then what happens is people who do have a job stop spending their money too, because now everybody else is getting worried about us entering a recession. Because if you're not spending money, then our economy slows going down, and if people are worried about us entering a recession, then people stop spending money and they start saving money to protect them against a recession. So when our economy is growing, then things compound, which helps the economy grow even faster. When the economy is slowing, then everything slows down. At the end of 2020 and going into 2021, we had more than 10 million Americans out of a job who didn't have an income stream. Now, some of this was kind of mitigated thanks to the help of the government through the unemployment system, but I'll get to that topic in just a second. Here's the thing, the financial pains we had in 2020 are trickling into 2021, because in 2020, we had 100,000 businesses permanently shut down. These were 100,000 businesses that were originally temporarily shut down because of the pandemic, and now these are 100,000 companies that are completely out of business. What that means is millions of jobs just vanished off the face of our earth, and so you have millions of people who are unemployed right now who don't have a new job opportunity out there, because we have so many jobs that just don't exist anymore, and that's millions of people who don't have an income to pay their mortgage, that's millions of people who don't have an income to make their car payment, and that's millions of people who can't can't go out and buy extra guac. The government and the Federal Reserve Bank have been trying to put a band-aid on our financial issues by just throwing a whole bunch of free money into the economy. But if you really want to fix the economy, then you have to start here. We need our economy to grow, which means we need companies to grow, which means we need companies to hire more people, which means people will have more incomes to go out and spend money. So this is the issue in our economy. We have millions of Americans who don't have a job, who don't have an income stream, and the root cause of this job loss is the pandemic. So now the question is, what's the solution to this problem? Well, if one of the biggest factors causing all this economic pain is the pandemic, then the most obvious solution is to make the pandemic go away. This is where the vaccine comes into play.
I'm not touching this Bill Gates vaccine. All they want to do is track me.
Look, I really don't think Bill Gates cares to track how many ho-hos or Twinkies you eat, but that's besides the point.
I am not your health advisor and I'm not your vaccine advisor. I'm here to talk about the economy and your money.
If a vaccine works and it can make this pandemic and this virus go away, or at least as far away as possible, that way people can go back to living their lives like normal, that way the economy can open back up like normal, that way companies can reinvest back into their companies and hire more people like normal, then our economy will be able to start functioning again. The goal was to deliver and administer something like 20 million vaccines by the end of 2020. We were nowhere close to that. The distribution and administration of the vaccine is going way slower than expected, which is kind of slowing everything down. Now, experts are saying that anybody who wants the vaccine will be able to have one by June of 2021. If the vaccines work and we can achieve some sort of herd immunity by mid-2021, then people will be able to start living their lives like normal, companies will be able to work like normal, and you will be able to go on your dream vacation again like normal. If the vaccine does not work, or a new strain of this virus comes out that is not protected by the vaccine, now you might be very stressed because you might not be able to go on the vacation you were planning to go on, but we're gonna have even bigger problems on our hands. If this vaccine does not work for whatever reason and this pandemic does not go away in 2021 and we continue to see lockdowns and economic slowdowns into 2022, now we're gonna see real economic chaos because everybody is betting on this pandemic and this virus going away in 2021. And when I say people are betting on this virus going away in 2021, I don't just mean that people are hoping that this virus is gonna go away. I mean, people are betting their livelihoods through the stock market and through their investments on this pandemic and this virus going away, and the entire government and our economic system is relying on it. Our economy is artificially moving thanks to the help of the United States government, because the United States government keeps printing more money, keeps racking up the national debt to keep throwing money into our economy. That way our economy can keep moving artificially. However, the only reason they can keep affording to do this is because everybody hopes and believes that our economy will start moving like normal very soon. It's kind of like you graduating college with a bunch of student loans and you don't have any money in your pocket, but you have a job opportunity that will start 3 months after you graduate, but you need to be able to eat during those 3 months, so you just live off of your credit card, and you think that it's going to be okay because in 3 months, you're going to start a new job, and once you start a new job, you're going to be able to pay down your credit card debt, and you'll be able to pay down your student loan debt. You just need to be able to survive those 3 months. Well, this 3 months is what our government is trying to get through. It's not actually 3 months in our economy, but it's that phase where we're just hoping everything will go back to normal. And so the government is funding this time through all this money printing and all this national debt. And speaking of money printing, Joe Biden has made it very clear that he's going to work hard to get more stimulus checks into the hands of Americans. I'm going to try not to get too political in this video because I don't like talking about politics on our channel, but in 2020, the United States government had a real tough time passing any stimulus programs because the House would pass one thing and then the Senate would reject it, and so nothing got passed. In 2021, things are kind of changing because the House is Democrat-leaning, and now the Senate is going to be Democrat-leaning because it's half Republican, half Democrat, and that tiebreaker would be decided by the Vice President, who is now a Democrat. So you have a Democratic House, and you'll have a Democratic Senate, and so we could see a lot more stimulus programs passed. So when it comes to stimulus checks, Americans got a $1,200 stimulus check when this pandemic first started, and then you likely got a $600 stimulus check in the early part of 2021, and now Joe Biden says that he wants to pass at least one more stimulus check. The purpose of these stimulus checks is to, one, help people out in their financial situations, and two, to stimulate the economy. Because when you get more money, whether it's through a stimulus check or through a bonus at your job, now you have more money to help out your financial situation, especially if you're in a hardship. And two, if you have more money, now you have more money to
spend. And remember what I talked about just a couple minutes ago? When you have more money to spend, now you're gonna spend more money. And when you spend more money, that helps the economy grow. So if people have more money, they're gonna be spending more money at Amazon and Walmart and Apple. And now if these companies have more money, hopefully they'll reinvest that back into their companies. That way they can create more jobs, which would help the economy grow. Now on the flip side of things, we also have to look at taxes, because Joe Biden has made it very clear that he wants to raise taxes, especially on the rich and especially on big corporations. Now, if we look at this kind of in a big picture scenario, if corporations, especially your big corporations, your Walmarts, your McDonald's, your Facebooks, if these companies have to pay more money in taxes, then either they're gonna do one of three things. Either they're gonna eat up these higher costs, or they're gonna raise the prices on their goods to make up for these higher expenses, or they're going to invest less money in growth because they have higher expenses through these higher taxes. I already made a video where I covered Joe Biden's tax plan in detail. So if you want to learn more about that and how that's going to affect the economy, I will link that video for you in the description below. So our economy still has a lot of uncertainty ahead because our economy is still hurting pretty bad. And we have millions of Americans out of a job. However, if this vaccine works and our country can go back to normal, and if these stimulus programs work to give people money to spend, to stimulate the economy and to help people survive financially, then we could see our economy boom. But if these things don't work, then we could see our economy continue to struggle for years into the future. Now that you understand the economy, let's talk about the stock market, because the stock market and the economy are different but similar. The economy is everything we just talked about. So this is how well companies are actually doing. This is how many people have jobs, and this is consumer confidence. The stock market, on the other hand, is where you can go and bet your money based off of how good you think the economy is going to do in the future. If you think the economy is going to boom in the future, then you'd be willing to put your money in the stock market because now you're betting on the future economic growth. If you don't think the economy is going to do good in the future, then you're not going to put any money in the stock market, or you would short the stock market because you're betting against the future of the economy. The stock market is a place where you can go to buy or sell little pieces of ownership called shares of companies that make up our economy. So if you go to the stock market and you buy one share of the Amazon company, now you're one of the owners of the Amazon company, and you get to share in the Amazon profits. You need to start by understanding what pushes the stock market up or down. And this is where people will give you a traditional MBA answer, which is something like, as companies make more money, their profits and their revenues grow. And as their profits and their revenues grow, now their market capitalization is higher. And as their market capitalization grows, then people will be more interested in buying their stock, and that will push the stock market higher. That answer is true, but it's not exactly right. At the very, very core, the thing that makes a stock go up or go down is not just how much money a company makes, or how much profit they have, or how fast they're growing, or who their CEO is. It's how much somebody else is willing to pay for their stock. If you go out and you start this guacamole company and you create this delicious guacamole and you are selling this guacamole all over the place and you're getting a ton of sales and you think that your company's worth $1 million based off of all your sales and your profit, but nobody's willing to pay you $1 million for your company, the most anybody's willing to pay you is $500,000 for your company, then what is your company really worth? $1 million or $500,000? Well, your company's only worth what somebody else is willing to pay. And if the most somebody's willing to pay for your company is $500,000, then your company is only worth $500,000, even though you think it should be worth $1 million. Maybe somebody will come along and pay you $1 million in the future, but right now it's only worth $500,000 because that's the most that anybody's willing to pay for it. It's the exact same thing in the stock market. I mean, you can look at how much money a company's making and how fast their profits are growing and who their CEO is, and all of these things are important and you need to look at these things. But at the end of the day, right now, the price of a stock depends on how much somebody else is willing to pay for that stock. All right, let's go back to the whiteboard to understand how this works, because you need to understand supply and demand to understand stock prices. At the core, you need to understand the demand side of things when it comes to the stock market, because when you have a lot of buyers for a stock or for stocks in general, now buyers are going to be fighting each other for a stock. So if a stock is trading at $100 a share and five people want to buy it, now one person might offer $100, another person might offer $100.05, somebody else might offer $100.10, and this pushes the price of a stock up. So when you have more buyers, this pushes the stock market up. But when you don't have a lot of buyers out there, because either people don't have money to invest in the stock market or people don't want to invest in the stock market, now it's the sellers who are fighting against each other to attract a buyer. And so now if you are a seller and you're selling a stock for $100 a share, but nobody wants to buy it, Now you might bring it down to $99 a share or $98 a share until you can attract a buyer. And so now you have supply but no demand, and that pushes stock prices down. The thing that you have to look at and really understand is what causes the demand to buy a stock to go up or down. Well, the first thing is how well a company is doing. This goes back to what we just talked about. If a company is making more profits, or if a company is growing really well, or if the CEO is really good, this can bring more demand to want to own the stock because people think, oh wow, this company is making a lot of money, or I think this company is gonna make a whole lot more money in the future, and so I wanna buy it because I wanna own a piece of the action. So if a company is doing really good and you've seen the company grow, then people will wanna own it, and this brings more demand into that stock. The second thing which affects stock market demand, which isn't as obvious, is how much money is out there in circulation. Because if you only have $100 to your name, then the last thing on your mind is gonna be buying stocks. You're gonna wanna go out and buy food, and you're gonna wanna be able to make your housing payment and your car payment. You're not worried about buying stocks because you're just trying to make ends meet. But if you get a sudden influx of cash, maybe you get a bonus at your job, or maybe you get a stimulus check, if you get more money, now you have more money to potentially invest. And so when there's more dollars out in circulation, this can create more demand in the stock market because people have more money to throw into the stock market. And I should also mention how interest rates play a part in this too, because if you are a company and you're trying to grow, but you just don't have enough cash to continue growing, well, now you can go out and borrow millions and millions and millions of dollars and pay next to nothing in interest on that money because our interest rates are lower than we've ever seen before. Now you have a sudden influx of cash through the help of the bank that you can use, and now you can use this cash to grow your company. And now if your company grows a whole lot more bigger, people will want to own your company because they see how fast you're growing. And on the flip side, if you are an institution, you can go out and borrow hundreds of millions of dollars, pay like 3% a year in interest, and throw this money back into the stock market, because if your money can grow at 5% a year, which is a very moderate return, well, now you just go and pay 3% to the bank and you keep the spread for yourself. So if companies are growing and they're making more money, this creates more intrinsic demand because people will want to be a part of this growth, and they will want to own stocks because they want to grow with the companies. And on the flip side, when there's more money in the economy, whether it's through all this money printing or whether it's through low interest rates, this creates more cash in the economic system, which can flow into the stock market, which can create more demand. This is where things get really tricky, because thus far, everything that I have said is good news for the stock market. However, on the flip side of things, the valuations of companies in the stock market are higher than we have ever seen. To give you the most extreme example of this, we can look at Tesla, everyone's favorite. So Tesla, at the time of me recording this video, is trading for 1,500 times earnings. If I translate what that means, let's say you started a business and over the course of the year, you made $1,000. That's it. You made $1,000 in your company. And if you sold your company at 1,500 times earnings, that means you would be able to sell your $1,000 company to somebody else for $1.5 million. Now, realistically speaking, if you started a company and you made $1,000, chances are nobody's going to be willing to pay you $1.5 million for that. However, Tesla is selling for 1,500 times earnings. That means every time Tesla makes $1,000, somebody's willing to pay them an extra $1.5 million for the entire valuation or market capitalization of the company. Now, from a value perspective, this makes absolutely no sense. You would never invest in a company at 1,500 times earnings as a value investor. But many people are not buying Tesla and companies from a value perspective. They're buying it for more speculative reasons. They think that this company will create new products in the future. They think that it's gonna have more market share in the future. They think that these companies are gonna grow way bigger in the future. And because of what they think is gonna happen in the future, they're buying today. That's why people keep saying that this is the most expensive stock market in history. It's not just because the stock prices are high, it's because the valuations of companies are high. And that's partially because everything was shut down in 2020. And so people are hoping that things will recover in 2021 once this vaccine gets rolled out and once the stimulus checks get rolled out. And so if the economy gets better and companies can grow, then either the companies will grow to meet their valuations, or we might see something else happen. If our economy does not turn around in 2021, either because the vaccine doesn't work as good as we thought, or because the stimulus programs don't work as good as we thought, or because the economy is way more hurt than we thought, then that could cause less demand in the stock market because now people start to panic and they start to worry about the valuations that they're paying for these companies, and they start to really worry about our economic future, then people could start selling stocks. On the flip side, as long as there's money out there and people are throwing their money into the stock market, whether it's their own money from their jobs or whether it's stimulus check money or whether it's money from these low interest rates, then that would keep pushing stocks higher. This is something you really need to pay attention to in 2021 when it comes to the stock market. You need to pay attention to companies. How much money is the company actually making? How well are they doing? What is the valuation of a company? You need to understand what you're buying. And then on the flip side of things, you need to pay attention to how much money is actually out there. Because if we get to the point where everyone's money is in the stock market and there's no more money left on the sidelines to go into the stock market, now there can't be any more demand because all the money is in the stock market. And if money can't keep pouring in, then the stock market has to come down because now you don't have any more buyers. Third, let's talk about the real estate market and the housing market, because the real estate market saw record-breaking growth in 2020. Just like the stock market, prices of real estate depend on supply and demand. And in 2020, we saw the prices of real estate skyrocket for a few different reasons. First, we saw the lowest mortgage rates in the history of time, which made owning a home a little bit more affordable. Second, we saw a limited supply of homes available, so there wasn't that many homes for people to buy. And third, we saw the sudden surge in demand to buy a home because all of a sudden in 2020, everybody wanted to be a homeowner. Let's start by talking about mortgage rates, because mortgage rates have never been this low before. I mean, you can go out and borrow $500,000 from the bank and you only have to pay the bank less than 3% a year on your mortgage. And so now if you want to go out and buy a home, you don't have to pay that much interest on your home. And if you own a home, well, now this is a great opportunity to refinance, because you can literally just go into a cheaper loan and pay way less money in interest. By the way, if you are interested in learning more about how to refinance your mortgage the right way, our team put together a very comprehensive guide on how to refinance your mortgage and how to save the most money on your refinance. So if you want to read that article, I'll link it for you in the description below. It's kind of funny. We've seen the same cycle happen for decades now. And anytime you want to stimulate the economy, what you do is you cut interest rates, because now borrowing money becomes cheaper. And so people go out and they borrow money, and then they go out and spend more money because you can borrow money and pay less money in interest. And so that's exactly what we're seeing happen in the housing market. Interest rates are cut, which means it's cheaper to get a mortgage, which means you have all these people going out to buy a home because they want to take advantage of these low mortgage rates. This is pushing the price of real estate up, because now you have all these buyers bidding against each other to buy a home. I'll take your home for $100,000. Did he just say $100,000? I'll give you $107,000. So on the demand side of things, we have a ton of people that want to buy a home. But on the supply side of things, we have a very small inventory of homes available for sale. Some people just don't want to sell their homes, and other people don't want to sell their homes because of the pandemic, and it's taking a long time to build homes because we have a labor shortage and a material shortage. So we have a very small supply of homes available for sale, and we have all these people that want to buy a home, which is pushing the price of real estate up. But the people that have kind of missed out on this housing boom are first-time home buyers, especially young millennials, because it's expensive to be able to afford the down payment on a home. I mean, if you want to buy a $150,000 home and you want to put 20% down, then you need $30,000 in cash. And a lot of millennials just don't have that because of student loans and credit card debt and other expenses. And so that's why Joe Biden wants to pass this $15,000 credit, which is essentially free money for first-time home buyers. That way, if you are a first-time home buyer, you can go out and buy a home and save $15,000 on your down payment because of this new program by the government. Now, at the time of me recording this video, this new bill has not been passed yet. But if this bill gets passed, and first-time home buyers get a $15,000 credit to buy a home, then what you're probably gonna see happen is a whole new wave of buyers enter the market. And if you see this new wave of buyers enter the market, then chances are we're gonna continue to see the housing market boom, because money will just keep flowing into real estate, because now you have a whole new wave of buyers buying homes. So the things that you wanna pay attention to in the real estate market going forward are interest rates, because if interest rates stay low, and it looks like they're gonna stay low for years into the future, then people will stay incentivized to go out and buy a home and refinance their homes. And then you want to look at the inventory of homes available for sale, because if you continue to see a housing shortage, then that could keep home prices inflated. And then you got to look at home demand, because if we see this $15,000 credit get passed, chances are that demand to own a home is going to go through the roof, and that would push home prices even higher. If on the flip side, the economy takes a turn for the worse and people lose their jobs and people can't afford their mortgage payments and people can't afford to buy a new home, then we could see the housing market really slow down. But real estate really is the backbone of America, which is why the government and the Fed are working so hard to keep home prices going up. If you enjoyed this video, here's a video that I think you'll love. And while you're at it, subscribe to our YouTube channel and join our free finance and business newsletter. And as always, keep hustling. It is gonna take you 40 years to save up $80,000, that way you can finally buy this $400,000 home. Now, obviously, there are alternatives.